Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Marika Walsh. I'll be moderating your press conference this afternoon. We have with us today Jean-Yves Duclos, Minister of Health, in the press conference room in Ottawa, and virtually we are joined by Procurement Minister Filomena Tassi. We'll take opening statements from the ministers and then turn to the room and the phone line for questions, and we have a total of 60 minutes for this press conference. Over to you, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Marie-Eke. Bonjour à tous et à toutes.
Hello, everyone.
Hello, everyone. I'm pleased to be here today in the virtual company of my colleague, Minister Filomena Tassi, to provide an update on the latest developments in our fight against COVID-19. On Friday, Dr. Tam and Dr. New presented the latest COVID-19 modeling data. The trend is clear. We can expect Omicron cases to continue to surge at very high levels while monitoring for a potential peak in the coming weeks. Though the individual risk of hospitalization is lower for Omicron, the sheer volume of cases will likely see further increases in hospital admissions. These forecasts underscore that we must continue to exercise prudence in order to limit the coming surge. We all know what to do. A, keep physical distanciation. B, wear a mask. C, stay prudent and limit in-person contact. And most importantly, D, continue to speed up our vaccination campaign. This is the best way to support and our frontline workers, our healthcare system, and help maintain the critical functions of society, our society. During this time. Vendredi, les docteurs Tam
On
et
Friday, Drs. Tam and New presented their latest modeling data for COVID-19.
La tendance est malheureusement claire.
The trend
Nous
is unfortunately clear.
We
can expect Omicron cases to continue to surge at a high level and to reach a potential peak in the next weeks.
Bien que les risques individuels
Even though risks to individuals for hospitalization are lower with Omicron, the sheer number of cases will increase hospital admissions. These forecasts let us know that we need to continue to exercise care to reduce the effects of the current wave.
Nous savons toutefois ce qu'il faut faire.
We know what we have to do.
Continue to maintain social distancing.
Two, make it wear a mask.
Three,
be careful and limit contacts. Four, continue to accelerate our vaccination campaign. It's the best way for us to support our first-line workers, to protect our healthcare system, and to help maintain essential operations of our society.
As mentioned in the past, although we are going through the worst phase of this pandemic in terms of cases and hospitalizations, January 2022 is not March 2020. We have plenty of tools and knowledge that we didn't possess back in March 2020. Public health measures, personal protective equipment, tests, and most importantly, vaccines are all essential tools in our toolbox in our fight against COVID-19. As of today, we are adding a new tool in our pandemic toolkit. As you know, this morning, Health Canada authorized Pfizer's treatment, antiviral treatment, Paxlovid. This prescription drug, which can be taken at home, will be used to treat adults with mild to moderate symptoms who are at high risk of progressing to serious illness. This is welcome news that we hope will help save lives, reduce illness, and lessen the burden on our healthcare systems and healthcare workers.
In addition to the tools we already have, for example, public health measures, mask wearing, rapid tests, and vaccination, today we are adding a new tool to our toolbox in the fight against COVID-19. Indeed, this morning, Health Canada authorized a new antiviral treatment called Paxlovid from Ce médicament sur ordonnance qui peut être pris à la maison sera utilisé pour traiter les adultes atteints de symptômes légers à modérés qui présentent un risque élevé d'évolution vers une maladie grave. Il s'agit d'une bonne nouvelle qui, nous l'espérons, contribuera à sauver les vies, à réduire la maladie et à alléger le fardeau porté par les travailleurs de la santé. I want to take a moment to thank, on behalf of all Canadians, all healthcare workers who continue to work tirelessly during this extraordinary time. You are Canada's heroes. And to all Canadians, I encourage you to express your gratitude to healthcare workers by following public health advice and getting vaccinated, whether it be your first, your second, or your booster dose. Let's be clear, no drug, including Paxlovid, is a substitute for vaccination and public health measures. Je veux profiter de ce moment,
I want to take advantage of this moment in the name of all Canadians to thank healthcare workers that are continuing to work tirelessly in this unprecedented situation. You are our heroes. I encourage everyone to express our collective gratitude to healthcare workers by respecting public health guidelines and by getting vaccinated, whether it's your first dose, your second, or your booster shot.
Soyons clairs.
Let's be clear. No drug, including Paxlovid, can ever replace vaccination and public health measures.
Thanks to our strategic pre-procurement approach, Canada has already received the first shipment of more than 330,000 treatment courses of Paxlovid, with another 120,000 on the way in February and March. To help inform with their planning, the Public Health Agency of Canada and its officials have provided provinces and territories with preliminary interim considerations on deliveries. They have also discussed deployment based on a per capita basis. With Paxlovid being authorized, distribution to provinces and territories will begin immediately. We are also working with Pfizer to firm up a longer-term delivery schedule with the intent of bringing additional treatment courses to Canada as quickly as possible. Grâce à notre approche stratégique en matière d'approvisionnement, le Canada a déjà reçu 30,000 traitements de Paxlovid en plus de 120,000 traitements dont la livraison est prévue en février et en mars.
Paxlovid ayant maintenant été autorisé,
la distribution aux provinces et aux territoires commence immédiatement.
Provinces and territories starts
now. Pour les aider dans leur planification, les représentants de l'Agence de la santé publique du Canada ont fourni aux provinces et aux territoires des indications au sujet des livraisons à venir dans le court terme. Ils ont également discuté du déploiement qui se fera sur une base
per capita.
Nous travaillons avec Pfizer pour établir un calendrier de livraison de plus long terme dans le but d'offrir des traitements supplémentaires au Canada le plus rapidement possible.
Additional treatments to Canada as
My
soon
dear
as possible.
Colleague, the Minister of Public Services and Procurement is here to tell us more. Over to you, Minister Tassi.
Thank you, Jean-Yves, and good afternoon, everyone. I acknowledge that I am participating on the land which is situated on the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabeg peoples, my hometown of Hamilton. Our government continues to take action to protect the health and safety of everyone in Canada, as we have been doing since the beginning of the pandemic. My department, Public Services and Procurement Canada, is working tirelessly with the Public Health Agency of Canada to procure the supplies needed to keep us safe. The best thing all of us can do to protect ourselves and our loved ones is to keep up the vaccination effort and follow public health guidance. We have enough vaccine doses in Canada right now for all eligible Canadians. But we also know that effective, easy-to-use treatments are critical to reducing the severity of COVID-19 illness for those in high-risk groups. In addition to vaccines, these treatments can save lives. This morning's announcement that Health Canada has authorized the use of Pfizer's COVID-19 antiviral treatment, Paxlovid, is welcome news. And it marks another important milestone in Canada's fight against COVID-19. In December, I announced that Canada had secured 1 million courses of the treatment. And today, I am pleased to announce that we have already received our first shipment of more than 30,000 treatment courses of Paxlovid, with at least another 120,000 on their way between now and the end of March. Aujourd'hui,
today, I am pleased to announce that we have already received our first shipment of more than 30,000 treatment courses of Paxlovid.
Traitement de Paxlovid.
There is at least another 120,000 treatment courses on the way between now and the end of March.
My officials and I continue to work with Pfizer in order to finalize the delivery schedule for the remaining treatment courses and to accelerate deliveries of this highly sought-after medication wherever possible. We will always do what is necessary to protect the health and safety of everyone in Canada, and that includes ensuring access to safe and effective treatments. After living with this pandemic for nearly 2 years, the latest wave has been particularly hard, but Canadians are doing all the right things to get through to the other side, and they continue to make sacrifices every day to protect themselves, their family, and their fellow citizens. We're going to get through this together, and I want you to know that your government has your back and is going to be with you every step of the way. We're going to continue to procure the supplies needed to get us safely through this pandemic. From securing safe and effective treatments to ensuring steady deliveries of vaccine doses and rapid tests, our government will not stop until we finish the fight against COVID-19. Thank you. Merci.
Okay, thank you so much, ministers. We have 45 minutes for questions. We will split the time evenly between the room and the questions on the telephone, and we'll start in the room with Abigail Beeman from Global News.
Hi, good afternoon. Given the limited number of this treatment on its way, a million courses, and given the backlog in PCR testing, the difficulty to get that test, and given that this drug needs to be given very early on in the course of the illness, how effective do you see this being both in the short and long terms?
Thank you. Well, the good news is obviously that we have one more tool in our toolbox. This is a relatively recent tool for which we were working very hard. The stock being now in Canada is significant, 30,000 treatments. They are being sent immediately to provinces and territories, so they'll be available for clinical use very quickly. So that's the good news. The work obviously involves for clinicians, doctors, and others to prioritize as Pfizer also says they ought to do, to prioritize the use of those drugs for the people that are most susceptible to benefiting from them. So there is clinical guidance which doctors shared this morning that clinicians will want to follow in order that this is used not only in the proper manner, but also for the most important people to be looked after.
And a question for Minister Tassi. Minister, we hear that this drug is quite expensive. I'm wondering if there's anything you can share about the cost and whether the cost has an influence on the 1 million number and whether you hope that you hope to buy more after that 1 million course. Any light you can shed on how much you hope to procure in future?
So we have procured 1 million. That's secured. And we have an option to procure another 500,000. From the beginning of this pandemic, we've been committed to Canadians. The health and safety of Canadians has been our top priority from a procurement perspective, whether it's vaccines, PPE, medical supplies. We've done everything that we can possibly do with the priority of keeping Canadians safe, and we're going to continue on that same track.
Canadian Press.
Prime Minister Duclos. What do we know about how many courses of antiviral like Paxlovid would be needed to treat high-risk patients?
Thank you for the question. 30,000 treatments have already arrived. 120,000 will arrive between now and the end of March. Each treatment comes with 10 actual pills, 5 days, 2 pills every day. And we expect those treatments to be, as I said earlier, quickly used by clinicians across Canada, not for all purposes, obviously. This, the directives, the guidelines provided by experts in collaboration with provinces and territories, these guidelines are very important, and they've been not only prepared, but shared with experts and provincial and territorial leaders over the last few weeks. So we expect that to come quickly and to not only to save lives, but also to protect the health of Canadians who would have who would otherwise be susceptible of ending up with a very severe case of COVID-19.
Also for Minister Duclos, what do you say to the statement from Chinese authorities that Omicron arrived in their country via a piece of Canadian postal mail?
Well, this is a conversation to be had with experts and scientists. As we know, and as the WHO has wanted to seek for quite some time, is more data and more transparent evidence from China on where and how the COVID-19 originated about 2 years ago now. So we expect that China to follow the guidance and respond to the requests of organizations like the WHO to provide, as I said, more transparency on not only what arrived, but also how we can work better together internationally with the WHO to make sure that whatever risk or outcomes arise in the future, we can better manage them at the global level.
Tom Perry with CBC.
Hi, Minister Duclos. It's actually a follow-up on that. What China is alleging is that an outbreak of Omicron in Beijing originated from a parcel or a letter that was sent from Canada. So given what we know about the virus, how likely do you think that is that that's the case? And if it's not the case, what do you think China is doing here?
Well, to be very honest with you, I don't know where that is coming from, and we'll check with officials and our partners around the world. I think this is something, but not only new, but intriguing, and certainly not in accordance with what we have done both internationally and domestically.
Given what we know about the transmissibility of Omicron, do you think there's any chance that a letter sent from Canada to China could have transmitted the disease?
Well, as I said, I'm no expert and would need to ask both for more information and more expertise on what is being claimed.
Ben, je dirais que, écoutez, ce sont les experts qui peuvent
trancher sur ce genre de questions. I would say that the experts can tell us what
opinion,
to think. I obviously have my own opinion, but for an opinion to be useful and credible, we need more information, and I think experts should speak to this.
Radio-Canada, est-ce que vous espérez avec cette pilule antivirale d'en arriver à une utilisation élargie pour possiblement plus largement que ce que l'on prévoit actuellement,
que ce soit pour les personnes qui sont plus vulnérables aux maladies graves?
Que l'on prévoit actuellement, que ce soit pour les personnes qui sont plus vulnérables aux maladies graves? Est-ce que avec les défis d'approvisionnement qu'on connaît, on sera même capable un jour d'élargir l'utilisation de cette pilule?
Will we ever be able to broaden the scope of the use? Answer. Experts would probably say that yes, because science is progressing pretty quickly. Today we have enough luck to have a medication that would work for high-risk members of the population. These people need to be treated in the short term, obviously in the long term too. But from what I've heard, there will be improvements on this type of treatment, and there will be other kinds of treatment that will be available in the next weeks and months that will allow us to treat different segments of the population or treat different or more vulnerable people better. Follow-up question. When do you
expect to see a significant impact on hospitalization rates throughout Canada.
Also,
we're competing with all other countries to get this drug. Are people playing dirty to get their hands on this medication?
Answer. In terms of supply, Minister Tassi and her team and the entire government
worked very well in the last few months. If we look at the international stage, we're among the first countries to have approved the medication, but also to have received the medication. There are certain countries who
adopted different
approaches in the last weeks, but to say today that we have treatment in Canada and to be able to distribute them quickly to the provinces and territories and to have informed clinicians how to use these medications is something to be proud about.
We have 30,000 doses for now.
We're expecting 120,000 in the next few weeks. But as you've suggested, like with anything else, like rapid tests and vaccines,
competition is high,
but Canada is doing a good job. One reason for this is that when we have to get combined supply and approval processes, we have to say that there is a lot of faith in Health Canada's approvals,
and so
when we get that approval, it makes it easier to get approval in other countries. So Canada is a leader among other countries. So when we're seeking approval, we need to follow up with supply and procurement.
And
that's what we're doing here with today's announcement.
Okay, we will now go to the phone lines as there are no more questions in the room, and we will come back to the room if there is time. Over to you, operator.
Thank you. Merci. For questions on the telephone, please press star 1 on the device's keypad. Pour toute question au téléphone, faites étoile 1 sur votre appareil. The first question, première question, est de Raphaël Pirot, agence
Raphaël Pirou from QMI Agency. You have the floor.
Oui, bonjour, Monsieur
question.
Duclos.
Hello, Monsieur Duclos.
Savoir, le traitement en ce moment vient d'être approuvé. Jusqu'à quel point est-ce qu'on peut parler?
With regards to the treatment that has just been approved, can we say that this is a turning point in the pandemic? Will it help us reduce hospitalization rates? Maybe not for the Omicron wave, but maybe for future waves?
Merci beaucoup pour la question.
Answer. Thank you for the question.
Que dirais, the first thing I would tell you is that donc, il est toujours préférable
it's better
de ne pas
to
être par la COVID-19
prevent than to treat. So it's better not to get infected to reduce hospitalization.
Ça, ça
but failing that, we can. And that's the only way to do that is through vaccination.
Terme,
so this is the best tool we can use both in the short term and the long term to protect us collectively and individually.
The second thing
is that there are some people who, because of their age or their immune system, or their access to vaccines, perhaps they are immunocompromised or more vulnerable. For these people, vaccination protects them less. And so for these people, Paxlovid
is
the most useful extra layer. It's an extra tool, but it's not better than vaccination. Much to the contrary, for most people who are listening, vaccination is really the way to go to avoid infection rather than have to be treated and cured or healed.
Malgré la bonne nouvelle d'aujourd'hui, il faut continuer à
insister sur l'outil
principal
qui est la vaccination, tout en célébrant le fait qu'on a un outil additionnel et surtout pour des populations plus vulnérables. We have to continue to focus on vaccination, which is the key tool, and now we have an additional protective layer for more vulnerable people. Follow-up question. With regards to procurement and supply,
la façon dont en ce moment on prévoit distribuer justement
How will this influence the distribution of the treatment? Currently, there are many guidelines to be followed before we can get our hands on this treatment. So one day, eventually, when we have millions and millions of treatment courses, can we expect these guidelines to be lightened? Answer, of course, this will help us treat COVID-19 in the long term, short term, of course, but mostly long term. This is a medication that will be used with other medications that are currently being developed. So more medication is good news. It allows us to better treat and heal people. But again, I would like to focus on the present moment, currently with Omicron and the current crisis. The best way to go is to get vaccinated and to respect public health guidelines. This is the main thing that will get us out of this pandemic.
Thank you. Merci. The next question is from Alex Ballingall from the Toronto Star. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Yes, good afternoon. Thanks very much. Just on the arrival testing regime that we have at the airport, we have Pearson Airport, WestJet, and Air Canada today coming out saying they want this requirement dropped for, I believe it was asymptomatic arrivals, or remove mandatory arrival testing, so I guess for the mandatory testing for everybody. Wondering what you would make of that, Minister Duclos, and if you think that's a good idea, if that's something the government is considering doing, given the limited testing capacity that we have, obviously, in this wave.
Well, thank you, Alex, for the question, and three brief elements as a response. First, we are in the middle of the Omicron crisis. I was looking at the numbers just a few hours ago. Globally, the number of active cases in the world has doubled just in the last 2 weeks. And the speed and the slope are very, very high. So there is a lot more Omicron-infected people now in Canada as of January the 17th, as they were obviously a few weeks ago, but just a few weeks ago, certainly. And as I said, the trend is of great concern. There is obviously a lot of Omicron in Canada. And in Canada, we have different levels of government. At the federal level, we have the responsibility to look after our borders, to secure our borders. And we take that very seriously. And we're using resources for testing, PCR testing at the border, which are different from the resources to which provinces and territories have access. So different responsibilities, different resources, and each of us at the federal or provincial level take our responsibilities seriously. The third thing I would say is that as the situation evolves, obviously we will keep adjusting our measures on all sorts of ways, in all sorts of ways, including at the borders.
I guess, like, you know, different responsibilities, different resources. The arguments that I've heard is that, you know, obviously testing in general, for PCR testing, the federal government could use the money and lab capacity that's going to these arrival tests to potentially help out provinces such as maybe Ontario and Quebec that are overburdened. I wonder what you think of that logic. I understand there's different jurisdictions, but maybe the capacity could be better used, I think some would argue. And then also, just to clarify the number of treatments quickly in the each or the number of pills in each treatment of the new Pfizer treatment, if you could just clarify, is it 10, 20 in each treatment, I guess, package?
Thank you again. On capacity, I would also add that I'm in constant touch with my colleagues, health ministers across provinces and territories, and we are working together to make sure that not only do we have a good understanding of responsibilities, and they obviously have a role, at least a word to say on how we fare at the federal level in assuming our responsibilities, but also access to the appropriate resources that we need to deal with those responsibilities, and that will continue. On I forget what your second question was, then.
About contribution. Oh, it's number of treatments. I'm not sure if I'm on the line anymore. The number of treatments.
Yes. So 30,000 treatments that come with 10 doses per treatment, 5 days, two doses per day. I understand from the technical briefing that you had this morning that it's the maximum number of days is indeed 5 days, and the treatments need to start no later than 5 days after the first symptoms have appeared.
Is there another question on the phone line? Okay, Minister, if there are no more questions on the phone line, I'll actually also ask you a question. Just on the vaccine mandate for truck drivers, could you clarify what the government is doing to monitor supply chains and whether it's leading to shortages and how the government will respond to that?
Thank you. I'll do that briefly. First, I think people are asking why we do that. Now, we do that because the best economic policy in the current context is a health policy that makes sure that everyone is protected from COVID-19, and the best protection is vaccination. We also know that this has been known for some time. Since November, all truckers and all trucking companies know that this is coming right now, and soon there will be perfect symmetry with the United States, because we both agree on both sides of the border that, again, protecting the health and safety of workers is also protecting the businesses that hire those workers and also protecting the supply chains. Now, as we have prepared for that, and as we keep monitoring the outcome of this important policy, my colleagues, Minister Agabra, Minister Tassi, obviously Minister Ng, others in the government, Minister Seamus, who is responsible, the labor minister, therefore with a direct and important relationship with federally regulated businesses, including the trucking industry. Now, we've been working very hard with them and successfully with them, because the vast majority of truckers have not made the right choice. They have had a vaccine. So we are procuring the level of support and supporting the level of engagement that the industry needs and deserves. And we'll do this for as long as COVID-19 is there.
Okay, thank you. It's my understanding we still have the phone line, so I'll ask again if there are questions on the phone.
Yes, thank you. Merci. Sorry for the inconvenience. De nouveau, pour poser une question, faites étoile 1 sur votre appareil. Once again, please press star 1 on the device's keypad if you have a question. La prochaine question est de Boris Prou, Le Devoir.
Next question is from Boris Prou from Le Devoir.
À vous la parole.
You have the floor.
J'aimerais savoir, Monsieur Duclos, comment Monsieur vous Duclos, sentez
I would
par
like
rapport
to know
au fait qu'on caractérise les non-vaccinés comme des personnes vulnérables, donc qu'ils pourraient être privilégiés et avoir accès à ce médicament en premier.
Unvaccinated are criticized and how they will have access to this medication. Answer, yes, some of them are indeed vulnerable. They're vulnerable by the mere fact that they chose not to be vaccinated.
Si je peux ouvrir une parenthèse rapidement, on doit aussi être
have a quick aside.
Lorsqu'on parle des
we have to be careful when we talk about people who are unvaccinated. There are many types of people who are unvaccinated. Some would like to be vaccinated but can't find the time to go. Others would like to be vaccinated, but would still like to wait more and have more information. Other people are getting their information from misleading sources, and other people are against vaccination as a whole. So when we talk about unvaccinated people, there are many people here. And among these people, there are many that are ready and might be ready very soon to actually get vaccinated. But the matter in which we treat unvaccinated people is that we have to treat them with kindness. In Canada, that's the way we do it. Regardless of where people are from, whatever their past is, whatever their choices, we accept them in our medical care centers. When they arrive at the hospital and they need help, they receive the help that they need.
Follow-up question.
Do you think that vaccine skeptics will then move on to use Paxlovid? Answer. I hope everyone will understand that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound in cure. If a person wants to avoid severe illness, first of all, because it's unpleasant, you have to remember that Paxlovid doesn't guarantee that a person will be saved. It just improves their chances of... It reduces their chances of developing severe illness.
People need to understand
that it's better to prevent than to cure. And that's why vaccination is always the basic, fundamental measure for protection of oneself and of others.
Thank you. Merci. The next question is from Ryan Tumulty. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Yeah, Minister, I'm wondering right now the ability to get a PCR test or even a rapid test across Canada is pretty limited. I'm wondering if you are concerned that this new treatment will be difficult to actually, you know, practically administer because it requires a positive test, especially since it has to happen within 5 days. Are you concerned that perhaps this drug will go unused because of that challenge?
That's a good question, and I believe experts answered a similar question this morning. And I'm not being an expert, I will provide a view which would not be as solid as the one you heard just this morning. First, on the people. Now, this is designed for people both that display, you know, characteristics that make them more susceptible to be vulnerable to COVID-19, and sometimes in circumstances in which it is more difficult for them to be treated. So people living in more remote communities with greater distancing from medical care provided in a hospital setting. So these types of people, immunosupprimised individuals. So it's a population that is already suffering quite a lot from COVID-19. So that's good news for that vulnerable population. Now, this being said, there is obviously an important informational work that needs to be done, not only with clinicians, doctors, and nurses, for them to get fully to be fully aware of the uses and the possible benefits of this new drug, but also for possible patients, people that, as you alluded to, might feel symptoms of COVID-19, but that would not necessarily think of having a test, a rapid test or a molecular test. So sharing that information in provinces and territories with people that would already be vulnerable and sometimes more marginalized in terms of access to health information and healthcare. So sharing that information is going to be key in making that treatment as effective as possible.
Yeah, and just as a follow-up, Health Canada set priorities, or public health agencies set priorities for who should receive the drug. And relatively high on that list is people who are not vaccinated. I'm wondering if you're concerned that the pill could act as a disincentive to people who haven't been vaccinated, that they'll see the pill as something they could do instead of getting vaccinated.
I think not. I don't think so. I think this pill is going to be quickly understood to be used for people who would, find it difficult to go through COVID-19 without the pill. But most of these people
will have gained from being vaccinated. No, you don't want to have to use that pill if you can instead be vaccinated. Vaccination is going to be a lot better at protecting you as a prevention measure. No, it's much better to be vaccinated and not to run the risk of having a severe case of COVID-19 than to have to be treated with Paxlovid because you're going to end up with a severe case of COVID-19. And I think most people will understand that, but it's obviously going to be important for every expert, doctors, public health officials in various provinces and territories to share that message so that, again, prevention is understood to be a lot better than just being treated or eventually cured for the disease.
Thank you. Merci. La prochaine question est de Mélanie Crête, La Presse.
The next question is from Mélanie Crête from La Presse. You have the floor.
Bonjour. J'aimerais savoir qu'est-ce qu'il y en est de l'approbation du médicament antiviral de Merck.
What's going on with the approval for Merck's antiviral medication, which was submitted for approval way before Pfizer? Answer. Thank you for the question. You would have to ask the Health Canada's regulatory experts. As you know, they are independent experts.
De traitements, de These are two separate treatments.
They are both very different from one another.
Avec Merck, so Merck's probablement déjà request, as you've probably Canada, understood, procède différemment et à une vitesse plus lente parce que des enjeux plus spécifiques
more slowly
avec cette,
because there are more specific There are some specific issues for this medication that has been submitted for approval some time ago. Follow-up regarding Pfizer. On the 30,000 treatments that have been received, how many will be sent to Quebec?
C'est autour de 6 000,
Answer,
si je me souviens
I believe
bien,
it's approximately 6,000 courses that will be sent to Quebec. So it's divided per capita. So it's 30,000 divided by the number by Quebec's population. So it's approximately 6,000 courses that will be sent shortly to Quebec.
And with that,
as I'm not a doctor, I shouldn't have specified how many doses this represents. Each treatment has three doses, three pills per day for 5 days.
Why a non-doctor would speak about these things, but I was asked a question earlier. So it's about the treatment. One treatment comes with three doses per day for 5 days. J'espère que c'est une réponse suffisante.
I hope that that's a sufficient answer.
Thank you. Merci. La prochaine question est de Pierre
The next question
Saint-Arnaud,
is from Pierre Saint-Arnaud from the Canadian Press. You have
oui,
the floor.
Bonjour, Duclos.
Thank you. Hello, Mr. Duclos. My first question is this.
It's about the cost. Par traitement, non
How
pas
much?
Par dose, là, mais par traitement,
what is the cost
implique,
per
là,
treatment, not per dose,
en fait,
that has two doses of three pills per day for 5 days? So it's three pills per dose. Two doses a day for 5 days. So that's actually a lot of doses. But for complete treatment over 5 days, how much are we going to be spending?
Answer.
You know what? Next time I'm going to ask you to come to the press conference to explain the dosage. But I will turn this over to Filomena Tassi, the Minister of Public Services and Procurement. She'll have a better answer.
Well, thank you, Jean-Yves. You know, in order to protect the commercially sensitive pricing information, we can't disclose those details. What I would say is we have been very clear as a government that whatever it takes to help better protect the health and safety of Canadians, that's what we're going to do, which is why we have taken the step of procuring these doses and really are delighted that they are here now, ready to be delivered to provinces and territories. And I want to thank Pfizer for the strong relationship in working with us that we are in the position we are today, which is on the day of approval that we have the doses ready and look forward to those being used by Canadians to help protect them from the severe impacts of COVID-19.
En sous-question, Monsieur Duclos, est-ce que c'est le plan d'avoir suffisamment de l'antiviral de Pfizer?
Have you planned to have enough of Pfizer's antivirals to be able to give them to anyone without having a priority list? So anyone who develops symptoms that could or could not be susceptible to grave illness, who doesn't satisfy the criteria, are we hoping to have enough to distribute to the entire population?
Answer,
two things. From what I've understood, governmental regulatory experts have said that
qu'elle a été fournie par Pfizer, c'est une soumission bien particulière
dont les tests cliniques
ont été faits sur des populations particulières.
Et ce sont pour ces populations particulières qu'on connaît
les impacts sur la réduction de la probabilité d'avoir des symptômes sévères.
Our understanding
de la
of the medication's impact in reducing odds of grave illness is for these vulnerable populations.
Deuxième chose, c'est qu'il pourrait y avoir une couverture plus large
that we could
pour
have broader coverage with this medication.
La fourniture par Pfizer d'informations cliniques
but Pfizer would have to provide additional clinical information.
D'autres médicaments fournis par
Alternatively,
Pfizer
there could be other drugs produced by Pfizer or other pharmaceutical companies that have clinical data to complement drugs like Paxlovid.
Thank you. Merci. La prochaine question est de Éric Plouf, Radio-Canada.
The next question is from Éric Plouf from Radio-Canada.
Bonjour,
you have the floor.
Ministre, pourriez-vous nous Hello, préciser
Mr.
votre
Minister.
Position
Can
à propos
tell us
de
what
cette demande de
publicité
les mesures à la cet appel de médecins hygiénistes, de compagnies aériennes, notamment, d'abolir l'obligation de faire passer un deuxième test PCR aux voyageurs aériens qui arrivent au Canada.
Test for people who cross the border on land borders. Answer, three things. One, the epidemiological situation in Canada and elsewhere in the world is deteriorating.
Qu'il y avait à peu près 31 millions de cas actifs.
I noted that there were 31 million cases of COVID-19 in January, and now they're over, in early January, now they're over 50 million. So the increase in numbers of COVID cases is very strong here and elsewhere in the world. The other thing I would add is this.
Nous avons des responsabilités au gouvernement canadien en matière
We have, at the government, responsibilities regarding managing the border. This is one of the sources of COVID-19 transmission. When people travel,
they contact other people,
they can catch COVID-19, and they can also transmit it to others through their travels.
Assumer ses responsabilités, le gouvernement canadien utilise des ressources qui sont distinctes
des ressources auxquelles les provinces et les territoires ont accès pour leurs propres opérations de test.
Nous avons nos propres fournisseurs et des
endroits différents,
so we have
évidemment, our own autour
des frontières auxquelles les fournisseurs sont actifs. Et la dernière chose, c'est qu'on a toujours fait, et comme les gens s'attendent à ce qu'on le fasse toujours, on va continuer d'ajuster nos mesures en fonction de l'évolution de la situation.
Adapt our measures to match the evolution of the situation. Follow-up question. So it's not a possibility for now. Answer, currently, no, that's not what's going to happen because of the situation. We don't think we've even reached the peak of infections. We're all hoping it's going to happen now, but we don't have any clear evidence to that matter. And when we look abroad, we see that the situation in other countries is worsening.
Thank you.
This will be the last question over the phone.
Very well. Thank you. Merci again. The next question and the last will be Palak Mangat from Parliament Today. Please go ahead. Your line is open.
Hi, thanks. This question is for Mr. Tassi. It's on the costing front. I did hear my colleague ask about the possibility of this treatment being quite an expensive one to secure, but you didn't really provide a clear answer other than to say that we can secure another, I think it was about $500,000. Can you clarify if that's on the same contract or if you expect to take advantage of that given some of the practical challenges that we know about securing test results and the like, or, you know, will it essentially depend on the uptake of the existing supply flowing in?
Yes. So, look, we're delighted to have secured this contract, which is, you know, for the million doses. We have an option for 500,000 more. I think the timing of this is also very important, which gets to your question, which is at a time where hospitals are, you know, filled and they're having trouble accommodating all the patients, that this antiviral, that the bottom line is that the effect is that it keeps people potentially out of the hospitals, is so very important. So we're going to monitor that. But this contract is for a million doses, but we have the option to exercise a purchase of 500,000 more.
Okay, thank you. And also to Minister Tassi, I know the government's sort of previous positioning on vaccine contracts, and I'm wondering if there has been any word yet to your office or the department around the Auditor General and when she could begin her audit into the contracts that we've got signed so far. And the reason I ask is that really seems to be the only source of transparency around vaccine-associated costs.
Yeah. So I would say this. Listen, let me be clear. From the very beginning, we knew that we had to act and procure in order to protect Canadians, and that's what we've done. There are, of course, times where the information is commercially sensitive, and we can't jeopardize the contract by disclosing that information, so we adhere to that. We are working tirelessly, of course, to get our hands on every possible measure that we know is critical to combat this fight against COVID-19. And so the assurance that I can give you is that every step of the way, we are always acting in the best interests of Canadians, looking ahead, procuring what's necessary, and doing that in a very responsible way, and ensuring that the health and safety of Canadians is first and foremost, and respecting that there are times where we can't disclose the amounts, and that's and we're not going to put Canadians' health at risk by violating those provisions and putting the supply at risk.
Okay, we are going to turn quickly back to the room for one or two more questions, since there were so many more on the phone, starting with Tom Perry with CBC.
Hi, Minister Duclos, you were asked this in French. I was just hoping to get you in English. Why are unvaccinated Canadians among the group of people considered to be at a high priority to receive this treatment?
Thank you. We heard the answer this morning by experts. What was also said, and what I'm pleased to repeat, is that in Canada, we treat people as they are, and according to what healthcare needs they may have. So that's what doctors and nurses do every day. They don't ask questions about people's choices or people's human nature. They look after people. They care for people. This being said, a drug is a treatment. No, it's much better not to have to be treated. And the best way to not to have to be treated is to be vaccinated. So you don't want to end up with COVID-19, even though you might be given a drug. No, that's not what you want. You don't want to have COVID-19. And the best way not to have COVID-19 and not to run the risk of being severely ill is to be vaccinated.
And we will go to CP for the final last question.
For Minister Duclos, Jim Brodsky with CP. Just to follow up on the earlier thread about China and Tom's questions on that topic. You mentioned you have an opinion about whether a piece of Canadian mail could introduce Omicron to Beijing. What is your personal opinion on that assertion from the Chinese authorities?
Well, the opinion that matters most has to be based on information and on expertise. So that's why we will all want to defer to the views of experts on that. And I will ask my own experts within the Public Health Agency of Canada to look at that.
So you're not ruling out the possibility that a piece of Canadian mail introduced the Omicron variant to China?
Well, I find this to be an extraordinary view. But again, I am not an expert, a doctor, or a virologist, and I will ask the right people to to provide and to produce the right advice and the right views.
This is an extraordinary allegation, but I'm not an expert. So I would ask virologists at Public Health Canada
to answer.
Okay, that
ends our press conference. Thank you to the ministers for being so generous with their time. That's the last press conference for today.